In today's video, we will reveal how Dr. Ricardo Rosencrantz, alongside with his assistant, performed a crazy bullet-catching trick that astonished Penn and Teller. This video is going to be a special video because not only will we be discussing Dr. Ricardo's bullet-catching performance, but as a bonus, I will also be explaining Penn and Teller's bullet catch. Let's do a quick rewind on what happened in the performance. Dr. Ricardo started off the performance by saying that 12 people had died while attempting a bullet-catching stunt. Only a few, like Penn and Teller themselves, have successfully performed this. He said that he really wanted to do this stunt, but he already had a wonderful life, so he found a solution for it. Instead of him performing the stunt, why not have someone else perform it for him? He then invited Allison on stage. Allison was very much excited to perform for this random stranger that looked like he came out of a children's movie. He asked Allison not to worry at all, because she won't get shot at if she stands in the zone of safety. Dr. Ricardo said that the best way to perform this bullet catch was to do it with someone who's already dead. Upon removing the clot, he revealed his late patient Balsamo. His assistant brought a tray in which several ammunitions for the gun, alongside with different colored markers placed inside the tray, and requested Allison to choose any colored marker and write her initials on one of the metallic bobs. He then requested Allison to carefully hand over the bullet to him so he will load it into the gun. He asked Balsamo to show Allison that his mouth was empty. He then placed a pane of glass in between him and Balsamo, so all the skeptics out there would know that he genuinely fired at Balsamo. He asked Balsamo whether he wanted to do this blindfolded, and he nodded. After having Allison examine the blindfold, his assistant took the blindfold. The moment he was aiming for Balsamo, the sign changed from the zone of safety to the zone of danger, and he requested her to move out of the way. His assistant then removed the glass casing and placed a blindfold over Balsamo's eyes. Upon firing the gun, Balsamo caught the bullet between his teeth and dropped it into the tray Allison was holding. Upon close examination by Allison, she confirmed that it was in fact her bullet upon which she signed her initials. Now, before I get down to the reveal, I want to give a quick shout out to my wonderful patrons for supporting my work. Their support is a reason I am able to improve my content and upload more regularly. Let's start by doing an analysis of the performance and find hints that will help us in figuring out how Dr. Ricardo performed his version of the bullet catch. He initially asked Allison to sign her initials on the bullet with any colored marker. A quick comparison of Allison's bullet in her hand and the bullet that was caught between the teeth of the skull, we notice that the initials look alike. But because of the studio lighting, the reflection inside the metallic bob really does not help in convincing us that it is 100% Allison's signed bullet. Since Allison was given the bullet right in her hand from the skull's teeth, and her confirmation showed that it was her signed bullet, we can conclude that the bullet caught by the skull was genuinely Allison's signed bullet. Dr. Ricardo then took the signed bullet with a pair of tweezers from Allison's hand and placed it into the barrel of the handgun. But right after he drops it into the barrel, the camera cuts to Penn and Teller, and an entire scene is missing where Dr. Ricardo would pick the gun off the platform. So when the camera cut back, it showed the assistant taking the platform away and bringing the pane of glass in between Dr. Ricardo and the skull. We can immediately conclude that Dr. Ricardo either flashed something or did something fishy at this moment, that the producers of the show had to cut it out because it would have given away the method of the trick. We already know that this is a magic show and the gun is not real, so obviously no bullet was being shot out of the barrel towards the skull. If we were to watch it in slow motion, we see that the gun upon pulling the trigger just ignited a flash paper above the handle that created the flash of fire. And the breaking of the glass was down by a hidden mechanism inside the base platform holding the piece of glass. Just by watching this slow motion clip, we can see that there is a small metallic pick that launches towards the face of the glass and then disappears back into the platform. Another thing we noticed fishy about the platform holding the skull is that there is some sort of slot near the base right over here. If you were to take a moment and look at this picture of the skull holding a metallic bob in between the teeth, you would start to question whether the metallic bob was even being held in between the teeth. If we were to zoom in and look closely at the bob between the teeth, we notice that it would not be physically possible to hold a bob like that between the teeth without having it immediately fall out, because of the curvature of the bob and the uneven forces attempting to hold the metallic bob. We can also see Dr. Ricardo's assistant holding something in her right hand right over here when she has her hands on her hips. You might have already guessed that she was holding on to the metallic bob the entire time. Based on these observations, you might have already figured out how this version of the bullet catch was performed. Since this trick did not fool Penn and Teller, let's see what Penn had to say about Dr. Ricardo's performance.
I have the overwhelming urge to talk about baseball. Been told when the bases are loaded,
In his code words, Penn started talking about baseball and mentioned particularly the words bases are loaded to describe something important about his performance. Penn also mentioned the following.
In an exciting game of baseball that no one is going to steal.
Penn used the term stealing to describe some portion of Dr. Ricardo's trick. And finally, Penn mentioned something about Dr. Ricardo's assistant using the following words over here.
Well, that blindfold, that looks awfully fishy. Assistant with a blindfold, we're gonna watch her like a hawk.
We can understand that what Penn is trying to say is the idea of introducing the blindfold into the trick being placed onto the skull by the assistant was actually an important phase in the trick that helped Dr. Ricardo accomplish this bullet catch successfully. For those who are regular viewers of my channel, they would have already figured out how exactly he performed this version of the bullet catch based on the hints and the code words that Penn said, but if you haven't figured out already, I will now quickly explain how it works. The reality of the trick is that no bullet was being shot, neither getting caught in this performance. The entire objective of the magician during the performance was to steal Allison's signed bullet and load it inside the base upon which the skull was placed. The only interesting thing about this performance is the moving skull that really did majority of the work for the magician. Even Dr. Ricardo's assistant did more of the work in executing the trick as compared to himself. After Allison having signed the metallic bob that was freely chosen and did not need any sort of clever switching, he took the metallic bob with a pair of tweezers, loaded it inside the gun, and then the camera immediately cut so that he was now holding the gun. During this moment, the metallic bob did not actually go into the gun, rather fell right into the base. As you can see in this animation, the bob falls through this rod over here and lands into the base. From here, the assistant takes the bob that is now in the base when she moved the platform away to bring the piece of glass in between Dr. Ricardo and the skull. We then see her holding onto the bob in her right hand right here, and with the excuse of taking off the glass casing and placing a blindfold on the skull, she loads the metallic bob into the base of the skull right over here in this slot, which we can see in this exposed angle. We already caught in the observations that the base holding the piece of glass had a hidden metallic pick that popped out and after breaking the glass immediately disappeared back into the base. This was controlled wirelessly by an assistant offstage, the same assistant who was controlling the motorized wireless movement of the skull. We also notice that the fire from the gun is flash paper being ignited by a spark specially designed to occur when the trigger of this propped gun is pulled. The main question is, how was the skull able to hold the metallic bob in between its teeth, and how did it appear in between its teeth when it was loaded into the base? Well, if you were to observe closely, the metallic bob really isn't being held, rather is attached magnetically with the teeth of the skull. This means, the teeth of the skull are magnets that are painted over to appear as if they are plastic teeth of the skull. Only the upper jaw teeth were magnetic. In order to get this metallic bob from the base into the skull, there was a tube that connected the slot in the base and connected inside the skull right over here, such that the opening was right behind the teeth. So, when the assistant loaded the ball into the base, it shot upwards with a mechanism like this, causing the bob to shoot up and get magnetically stuck behind the teeth. And in order to produce the bob, all the assistant backstage had to do with this remote was have the skull open his mouth. By opening his mouth, the space between his teeth opened and bob that was attached magnetically due to its weight pivoted outwards and was stuck near the tip of his teeth, as you can see in this diagram. I will now explain Penn and Teller's version of the bullet catch. But before I do, let's do a quick rewind of what happened in Penn and Teller's performance. Penn and Teller called their bullet catch routine as the magic bullets. Penn asked random people from the audience to raise their hands if they knew 357 Magnum handguns. Penn and Teller invited them both on stage and invited them to stand on the opposite sides of the yellow line and asked them to be very cautious to never cross the yellow line. Penn pulled out an ordinary purse of bullets and asked the spectator to select any bullet and examine them. After having the bullets examined and confirming that they were ordinary bullets, he asked the spectator to sign the tip of the bullet with their initials. The same instructions were followed by Teller's spectator as well. Penn then asked Teller's spectator what he wanted to draw on the casing of the bullet, and he said he wanted to draw a flower. He then asked his own spectator what he wanted to draw. He decided to draw a lightning bolt. After drawing both of their respective images on their bullets, they were showcased in front of the camera close-up. Penn and Teller then introduced two pieces of glass on either sides, placed on a stand, and had the spectators confirm that it was a real piece of glass. Penn then briefly explained what he was about to do. He said that that tip of the bullet he is holding will move across the yellow line to the other side and vice versa with Teller's bullet, without anyone ever crossing the yellow line, and this will be done using magical wands. And while saying that, he pulled out a handgun from his inside coat pocket. He said that this 357 Magnum handgun is the same as you would buy from a gun shop, the only addition here is of a laser sight underneath the barrel. He then asked each other's spectators to examine the handguns and confirm that they were not gimmicked in any way. After confirming from the spectators, he asked the spectators to watch carefully as he places their bullets with their initials and drawing inside the revolver. Penn then asked the spectators to go back to their seats to not get in the way of danger. Penn and Teller both started to prepare for the bullet catch by first adjusting the safety frames while Penn was narrating gun safety rules. Then both of them wore a bulletproof vest and a helmet and pointed the guns at each other's mouth. Upon Penn's call, both of them shot at each other and caught the bullets in between their teeth. They then invited both the spectators back on stage and Penn asked Teller's spectator to confirm whether he caught his bullet with his initials on it. At the same time, Teller had Penn's spectator examine and confirm whether Teller really caught the bullet with his initials on it. Upon confirmation, both the spectators accepted the fact that their bullet really were shot across the stage and caught in Penn and Teller's mouths. Furthermore, Penn had the spectator examine the bullet and confirm whether it smelled like it was fired and also confirmed whether the bullet was hot. They also had the spectators confirm whether the bullet end really looked like they were shot out of the bullet casing from the handgun. Finally, Penn asked both of the spectators to examine the holes in the pieces of glass to confirm a bullet really did pass through it. After seeing how Dr. Ricardo performed his version of the bullet catch, you might be completely clueless and puzzled as to how Penn and Teller performed their version. Since Penn and Teller's version seems a lot more complicated and deceptive as compared to Dr. Ricardo's version, because of the fact Penn and Teller gave so many provers before and after the bullet catch to remove any sort of skepticism. After watching Penn and Teller's performance, an immediate assumption we might have about how this bullet catch may have been performed is by using duplicate signatures on the bullets that were signed by the random spectators. Of course, this could have been executed with Penn and Teller's assistants backstage, who had the ability to zoom in on the camera when Penn and Teller displayed the tip with the spectators' initials on them. During this moment, the assistants backstage could have attempted to copy what they saw in the zoomed-up image onto another set of bullet ends, that would have been later switched with during the performance. But this theory can be thrown right out the window by just doing a quick check on whether or not the signatures are exactly the way they are on both the bullets before and after they were shot. This can be done by comparing the screenshots. Upon comparing Penn's spectator's initials on the bullet tip, before and after the bullet was shot, you can see that the signatures are exactly the same. Similarly, if we were to compare Teller's spectator's bullet end before and after it was shot, you can see that once again, the initials on both the bullets are exactly the same. This proves that no such method of duplicate initials were used to perform Penn and Teller's version of the bullet catch and the bullet genuinely did move across the stage. But the real question is, how did they move across the stage when we know logically that they never really shot the bullet from the gun and attempt to actually catch it? To figure this out, let's do a very thorough examination of the act. If you were to watch this act from the start till the end, not at any point did Penn nor Teller ever cross the yellow line that divided the stage in half, and the only occasion they ever did cross was after the bullets were shot and caught in between their teeth, and while they were handing over the bullets to their respective spectator, only then did they move their head across the yellow line. We can conclude that there is something else going on in this trick that really has nothing to do with the yellow line at the center of the stage. The yellow line, in fact, acts as a misdirection for the audience to direct their attention to, leaving them completely fooled and clueless of how in reality they got the bullets across the stage, and even into their mouths without directly placing anything into their mouths with their hands. Another important thing I want to bring into the spotlight is about the bullet case and the bullet ends. If we were to see the bullet end after it was shot, and compared with the bullet end before it was shot, we can see that a portion of the bullet is hidden right at the end of the bullet case. This end that appears to look like it was shot out of a gun is hidden when it is covered by the bullet case. So in the beginning, when he had the spectator pull out any bullet and examine whether it was a normal bullet, the spectator did not at any point try to pull the bullet end out, and neither did Penn and Teller ever ask the spectators to confirm that the bullet end was securely stuck into the bullet case. Therefore, we can easily conclude that the bullet end inside the bullet case is not fully secure, rather loosely stuck inside temporarily. Furthermore, at the moment Penn was loading the bullet inside the revolver, we notice him telling the spectator to watch the initials and the lightning bolt.
Dana, I want you to see your initials. I want you to see if I rotate that, your lightning bolt, see it right there?
Yep.
When in fact, if you were to watch carefully, Penn had covered the tip of the bullet with his fingers and never really gave the spectator a chance to see the tip of the bullet before he placed it into the gun. After the bullet end was hidden inside the gun, only then did he display the thunderbolt and completely push the bullet inside. An important observation that won't make sense right now, but will later play an important role, are these safety panels standing on opposite sides of the stage. We then catch something fishy in Penn's mouth before Penn and Teller even shot their handguns. If you were to pause right at the moment Penn opens his mouth, you can see something right underneath his tongue right over here. Furthermore, after the bullets were shot, we notice that Teller immediately catches the bullet in between his teeth, but Penn can be seen fetching for the bullet in his mouth before displaying it in between his teeth. Finally, the main question you will have in your head is how did both the pieces of glass have holes in them, if the guns that Penn and Teller were using were not real? And even if the guns were real, this would not be a magic trick, rather a real stunt that will be putting Penn and Teller's lives in danger, which is clearly not the fact here. To make sense of all these observations, I will now explain in detail how exactly Penn and Teller performed their version of the bullet catch. The bullets that Penn and Teller used in the performance are no ordinary bullets, rather prepared bullets that can simply detach the bullet casing from the bullet end. The bullet end genuinely was a pre-shot bullet. Therefore, when the spectators were asked at the end of the performance whether it was a bullet that was shot, they would have no choice but to say yes.
Recognize that bullet, Chris?
Yes, I do.
Is that the one you signed?
Yes, it was.
Furthermore, Penn and Teller were not the only ones that were performing the trick, rather had two assistants helping Penn and Teller. These assistants were in plain sight, but no one realized they were in on it. No, I am not referring to the two random spectators that were on stage with Penn and Teller. They genuinely were random spectators and not stooges. In order to perform this trick, Penn brought out a purse that contained several bullets. All the bullets were prepared such that the bullet end was pre-shot and then placed inside a bullet case that was brand new. The bullet case inside had small amounts of gunpowder. The reason the bullet case had gunpowder inside it was because at the end of the performance, when the spectators had a chance to smell the bullets upon Penn's request, they can confirm that the bullet cases were freshly shot from the handgun.
Give that a whiff, Chris. Ah, it's a great smell, isn't it, Chris?
Yes, sir, it is.
Now going back to the bullet selection, since all the bullets are pre-prepared, it didn't matter which bullet the spectator selected. After having the bullets selected by Penn's spectator and Teller's spectator, both of them had the spectators sign their initials on the bullet ends. After displaying the initials the spectator wrote, Penn and Teller then had the spectators sign the bullet casing. Up until this moment, the bullet cap and the bullet end had not been detached at any point. So far, nothing fishy has actually happened, but it was when the spectators were handed over the guns to examine, was when the sleight of hand started. If you were to slow down the moment Teller and Penn were handing over the guns to the spectator, Teller can be seen grabbing the spectator's mic immediately, and then the camera cuts immediately to the spectator's hands while they're examining the guns. If you haven't caught on already, the mics were actually props involved in performing this trick. When the spectators were examining the guns, Penn and Teller took the bullet ends and loaded them inside the microphone. And after having examined the gun, we can see that Penn immediately has the spectator grab the microphone to move the attention away from this action of taking and giving the microphone out of the audience's memory, so they couldn't reverse engineer what had happened. So right now, at this moment, when Penn asks the spectator to come closer towards him while he loads the bullet into the revolver, the bullet end is actually inside the microphone that the spectator is holding, and we already spotted in the observations that Penn never showed the bullet end to his spectator before placing it into the gun. This is because the bullet never really existed inside the bullet casing when it was being loaded inside the revolver. After having loaded the revolver with the bullet, Penn and Teller asked the spectators to go back to their seats. By asking the spectator to go back to their seats, they took their microphones along with them. And it was at this moment we spot Penn and Teller's secret assistant right over here, that is about to perform an important role in this bullet catching routine. When Penn was talking to the audience, and giving general instructions to keep their eyes covered with their fingers and was adjusting the safety frames at the same time narrating gun safety rules, both of the assistants took the bullet ends out of the microphones and loaded them into the bulletproof vests that were hanging on the stands on the opposite ends of the stage. Which you can see right over here, behind Teller and for Penn right here in this frame. The bullet ends are actually stuck right behind the vest, as you can see in this animation. While Penn is talking, he quickly placed the bullet into his mouth and he pushed it right underneath his left cheek. You can even notice this happening in real time as I play the original footage.
Always treat every gun as though it were loaded, as you yourself.
For Teller's case, since he wasn't talking, it wasn't as difficult for him and the attention was not toward him. So, he did not have any trouble placing the bullet into his mouth, it was only challenging for Penn. We can even spot a slight bump in Penn's left cheek as he is talking. This is also the reason why we already spotted the bullet end in Penn's mouth right before the bullets were actually shot, because he was holding it inside his mouth the entire time. Now the question is, if the bullets are now in Penn and Teller's mouths, then how did the guns that Penn and Teller were holding create a hole inside the piece of glass? Even if we were to examine the stands that were holding the pieces of glass, we notice that no such mechanism could exist that could produce a hole inside the piece of glass so perfectly, since the stand was extremely thin as compared to Dr. Ricardo's stand that could hide a whole human inside it. Well, the answer to this question is surprisingly in one way dangerous but extremely clever at the same time. I want you to watch this slowed down clip of the moment Penn and Teller fired the handguns at each other. We notice a flash of fire from Teller's gun and then a white color beam of dust produced by something passing through Teller's piece of glass. And then we see Penn's handgun shoot that produces a similar white beam of glass that moves from the left side to the right side of the stage. Furthermore, if we were to zoom in near Penn's head, we spot something bouncing off the safety stand behind him and moving right over here in this frame. If you haven't figured out already, the guns that Penn and Teller were using were real guns, but contained rubber bullets. These rubber bullets aren't obviously as dangerous as real bullets, but they can be extremely dangerous if they weren't wearing safety goggles, and several safety equipment such as the bullet vest. Since they were wearing both these equipment, it made the performance comparatively safer. The laser beam that apparently pointed directly into Penn and Teller's mouths was actually not parallel with the barrel of the handgun, rather was deflected at a slight angle. The reason it was deflected at a slight angle was pretty obvious, so that they could confirm that they were genuinely not aiming into each other's mouths and save each other from any sort of injury. The bullet holes created inside the glass was the rubber bullets passing through the sheet of glass. If you have made it this far into the video, be sure to like and also consider subscribing. I would really appreciate your support. If you want to support the channel and at the same time get access to exclusive reveals only for my patrons, join the $10 tier of my Patreon to gain exclusive access today. For those who want to request magic reveals and chat with me live, they can join my $30 tier.